Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us here tonight. My name is McKaylee. I'm with Tattered Cover Bookstore. And I first and foremost want to say thank you. Thank you for being with us on this program tonight. Thank you for shopping locally. Thank you for supporting local independent bookstores. Tattered Cover turns 50 this year, 50, which is huge for an independent bookstore. And we wouldn't be able to do it without you. We wouldn't be here without the support of our community members supporting us, not only just through this past year, which has been crazy all the way around, but for the last 50 years. It's because of you that we're able to bring in authors like the ones that we have tonight, which is very exciting for us. Thank you for being a part of our virtual community. Tattered Cover is known for being a community space in the Denver metro area with its four locations across Colorado, with a fifth one opening up this summer, which is very exciting. And we are grateful to be able to have a virtual community in this way, because even though we can't be together physically, we're grateful for your presence here tonight virtually. So speaking of Tattered Cover, like I said before, we are located in four locations in Colorado, and right now all of our stores are open, so you can come and visit us as long as you're wearing a mask over your mouth and your nose. You can come shop around for about 90 minutes or so, breathe in the books and the atmosphere. But if you're like me and you prefer to shop in your pajamas, or if you're not in the state or within driving distance, you can always shop online at tatteredcover.com. There is where you also can check out our events at tatteredcover.com/event. We have so many events coming up. It's very exciting to see what's on our calendar, and I'm loving every second of it. We have debut author Laura Maylene Walter and her new book, Body of Stars, which is March 22nd. And for the historical fiction lovers out there, Martha Hall Kelly, who's known for her World War II historical fictions, her new book Sunflower Sisters comes out in April, and we are hosting her on April 5th. And you can find those events and more at tattercover.com/event. I want to also let you know that closed captioning is enabled for those who might need it. There is a black bar down at the bottom with a button labeled CC on it. If you click that button, closed captioning is enabled should you want it or need it. And now I have to talk about these wonderful authors that we have here tonight. I'm very excited for both of these. We have W. Ralph Eubanks, and he's going to be in conversation with Wright Thompson tonight. And so Wright Thompson is the author of two New York Times bestsellers, Pappyland and The Cost of These Dreams. He's also a senior writer for ESPN. He lives in Oxford, Mississippi with his family. And then we have our author of the hour, W. Ralph Eubanks. He's the author of Ever is a Long Time and The House at the End of the Road. He's written for the Chicago Tribune, Vanity Fair, Time, The Wall Street Journal, Wired, The New Yorker, and NPR. Tonight, we're celebrating his new book, A Place Like Mississippi. And it is my honor to welcome both Ralph and Wright, and we're going to have them join me here on Zoom, turn their cameras and microphones on. Welcome. Hi, Wright.
Hi.
Hi, Ralph. Hello. Thank you both for being here this evening. I'm just so enamored and so excited that we get to celebrate this with you. What a fantastic book you've graced us with, Ralph. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having us.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Well, I want to let the audience know that there will be time to take your questions in the comments. Some of you are already active on the chat that's next to us on the screen here. So keep those questions in mind. We'll have time for that later tonight. But first, I'll let the two of you take it away.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to be here, especially for such a fabulous book. I guess, Ralph, let's start for people who haven't read it and explain what it's about and what made you want to do this.
It is a journey through Mississippi's literary landscape. Mississippi has a great number of writers. It's kind of exploring that question, why does a little state along the borders of a great river have produced so many writers? And I take the reader on a journey through the state, beginning on the Gulf Coast, where I am right now. And it's down the road in Gulfport where we begin, but here I'm here in Pass Christian, Mississippi tonight. Take you from Gulfport through the Piney Woods, which is where I am from, over to Natchez and Vicksburg, into Jackson, up through the East Mississippi Hills, into Oxford and the Delta. And I conclude with the last chapter at Parchman, a place that really figures looms large in the literary imagination of Mississippi, I would say even in this country as well.
You know, having grown up in Mississippi, I obviously know what parchment is. It's the home of the Mississippi State Penitentiary. It is a brutal, violent, scary prison with a really terrible history. I'm curious if you could explain what the intersection is of the ghost of that place and of the literature that is the engine of the book.
I thought about a lot of the writers who have been inspired by parchment or have described parchment in their work. You know, Faulkner calling it Destination Doom, also being described in Eudora Welty's Losing Battles, and then again in Sing Unburied Sing by Jesmyn Ward, where says that this is a place for the dead. The reason I decided to end it there is that I learned about a writing program that was at Parchman, run by Louis Bourgeois in Oxford. And I had read several of the anthologies of the work there and realized that probably inside those prison walls were some of my fellow Mississippi writers. And then I thought about a Mississippi writer who had spent time in those prison walls, and that was the poet Etheridge Knight. And I began to think, if Etheridge Knight, who was in prison in Indiana and got educated in prison, got the notice of Gwendolyn Brooks for his poetry, had he committed that same crime in Mississippi, he never would have created that poetry, because he would have been working, chopping cotton, picking cotton, working on Parchman Farm, and we would not know that poetry. So now, thinking about the people who are there, who are creating work, like one writer who mentioned in his memoir that poetry comes with an entourage, and those words really stuck with me.
You know, it's, you know, you think about, you know, I'm in the hotel room in St. Louis right now, and the Mississippi River is right there. And, you know, you talked about this little state with all these great writers alongside this big river. I'm curious, what do you think the presence of that river, which was, I mean, I think a lot of historians would say the first interstate highway in America. What do you think that the river forming the western border of Mississippi has to do with, I mean, all of the writers, obviously, that you mentioned, the very famous ones, and the many, many other ones who, you know, whose work we love, who don't rise to the level of Jesmyn Ward or William Faulkner, but, like, you know, the state is full of people doing this. And I'm curious what the river has to do with that.
I think the river does several things. I think for some, it's a symbol of imagination. It's a symbol of movement. For others, I think it's a symbol of a frontier, because crossing that river, it's the beginning of the frontier. Once you're on the other side, you are into the West, even if you are in Louisiana, that's the beginning of frontier. It's, and also because of Mark Twain, when I spoke with Bill Ferris about, you know, what was it about the Mississippi River that really captured his imagination? And he said it was the work of Mark Twain that really got him into the river. And he said the Mississippi River, you know, being from Vicksburg, means more for him, to him, than any Civil War battle that took place along that river.
You know, one of the things that I thought was, trying the right way to ask this, I thought was really interesting about the book was considering that all, the various Mississippis that all these people you wrote about were the voices for, right? You know, if Faulkner is the voice of the incredible clearing of the Delta between 1890 and 1920, then when you look at, you know, like say Jesmyn or KSA, or frankly you, like the people who are putting books out now, what do you think, what Mississippi is being represented in print that wasn't, in your opinion?
I think the very idea of that blackness has its origins in the American South, that idea of of Blackness. I think that comes out in the work of Natasha Trethewey, where she talks about Mississippi being this place that, you know, where she will be buried, but the place that also made a crime of her. That, you know, she says Mississippi gave her her first wound. And I think that that's the, that is the thing for most of us, is that in, especially for Black Mississippians, this is the place that gave us our first wound. And if we focus on that a lot, eventually it will come out somewhere on the page. And I think that's really where it comes out, especially for Natasha and Jesmyn and Kiese.
You know, you and I, a phrase you've used before when we were talking is, I think unresolved grief was, I think, your phrase, yeah, when you talk, yeah, about the things in physical, like, I guess, metaphysically, actually, in the dirt in Mississippi. And I mean, I'm wondering how much of this literature across a really sort of shockingly long arc of time that has been created in this place, like, what do you think is the relationship of that unresolved grief? Or there's a quote in the book where you talk about, you know, if you want to tell a Mississippi story, you have to listen to the silences.
Yes.
So I'm curious if you could define what those silences are. I guess this is the best way to ask it. Yeah. Tell me what those silences are and in what ways the literature tries to stand in opposition to them.
The silences are the stories that people either don't want to tell or are afraid to tell, for fear of social retribution, sometimes political. There are things that, you know, that we just don't want to confront. So that's why I say always kind of explore those silences, and things begin to come out. So I guess that's really the core of it all. All those things that Mississippians try to turn a blind eye to. And that's all connected with that unresolved grief. I mean, a great example of that I come to in the book is, I'm trying to imagine this world that Kiese came into in Jackson and that Angie Thomas did. I go back to Margaret Walker, Alexander Boulevard, which was once Gine Street there. Go to the Medgar Evers house, go inside. I'm talking with the curator, and the curator tells me about the people who lived in the neighborhood who didn't talk about what happened there. And then she mentions a family that lived across the street. I said, I know that family. And then I realize, I look out the window, I played at that house. All that time that I played in that neighborhood, no one told me that house across the street, whose yard I probably used to walk through while we were playing some game on the street, was the house where Medgar Evers was murdered.
It's like those places around the Delta that are the Emmett Till memory sites, where you just are driving down the road and they're like, oh, right there. And it just, the fact that it is so unremarkable is what is shaking about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's there's this trauma that is embedded in the very geography of this state. It's why I say you look around Mississippi and you see great beauty, but then when you start to probe those silences, that's when some of the trauma and unresolved grief starts to rise to the surface.
Yeah, I mean, there was a cross burn in our yard in 1982 and we never spoke about it. Do you know what I mean? So both things. I mean, you know, just the silence as a defining characteristic in a state most famous for its music and its literature. I feel like there's something in that collision that A, is responsible for those two things, but B, says something about us that I'm not quite articulate enough to understand. I mean, I'm curious what you understood about Mississippi at the end of this that you didn't really know before you started.
I think probably the most important thing that I came to understand was the ways that we have, that maybe sometimes our use of this landscape to create these beautiful things is to hide our wounds, or maybe sometimes to try to cure those wounds. I think that's probably, I mean, I think I went into this book thinking about this as a project that told this great story about Mississippi's literature, but then I realized that so many of the writers that I spoke with, including Jessamyn, often talked about their woundedness. And that woundedness being on the landscape, that I don't think I'd really thought about that. There are places that I drive now that I see very differently. I drove through DeLisle, Mississippi on the way here, through Jessamyn's, and looking out on that, you know, that grove of live oaks where I spoke with her that day, but also realizing that just beyond there, now her husband's buried there. Another piece of grief that's on that landscape. I was aware of that as I was driving through there.
I mean, yeah, for me, as someone who likes to drive around Mississippi, but who also feels that it is very freighted, like, I thought that, because it's not just a book about, obviously, a book about Mississippi writers, as much as it is a book about the intersection of Mississippi writers and the physical landscape and like the actual dirt and the state itself and the way we talk about hard to name metaphysical ideas by talking about the dirt and the trees and the land and the hills and the flat and all that. And I'm curious.
The way we talk about the people and then the people that we put there and the people that we connect with the land, whether it's some physical way that they are involved with that land or they're very presence there on that land. I mean, I tell you a place that I thought about a lot that I hadn't really thought about before was after reading Brad Watson's body of work, thinking about that part of Mississippi where he is from. It really hit me hard when he died because I see him there on that landscape, and I see the people that he placed on that landscape. I can't go into Weidman's In Meridian and not think about the heaven of Mercury. So things that he has given to us as a way of, I think, maybe trying to heal our wounds.
Is there anything that was healed for you by doing this?
Yes. I think this is a book that I was working on as I lost my mother. So this is a way for me to work through some of that grief. My mother is, the book is dedicated to my wife, but also to my parents. It's the two Alabamians who made me a Mississippian. And these are two people who very much identify with being in Alabama, but they're both buried on Mississippi land. The worst thing you could ever call my mother was a Mississippian.
did you ever consider going across state lines for the funeral?
No, because my father was buried in. So he died 45 years ago, last Friday. It's been 45 years. I'm like you, both of our fathers died young. My father died at 52, your father died at 58. It's 41 years between his death and her death. And then coming back there, and I just visited the cemetery for the first time since she was buried there. I spend more of my time in Milestone, Mississippi, kind of imagining them in that place, coming there as newlyweds. And it's where I can imagine them as really vital young people rather than thinking about them in their last days. So this was a book that for me allowed me to work through some of that grief.
You know, you mentioned Milestone, Mississippi. My dad's from Bentonia. So every time I would go home, we would go through there up to Chula and then over. I just was looking at a bunch of old WPA photographs from Milestone. And I'm curious, kind of said curious like 30 times. I am. I wonder why you think that Mississippi, you know, the book deals with Mississippians processing their own home. I'm curious why you think so many people come from the outside. I mean, Mississippi is one of the most photographed places in America, you know, and you know, it's pretty incredible when you start, if you want to know about somewhere in Mississippi, there will be really famous photographs of it. What is it about Mississippi that captures the imagination of people who aren't from Mississippi, do you think?
I think it's our mythology that really attracts people. And I think that's one of the things that I was trying to do with this book, was to deconstruct some of that mythology. I've seen so many people come to Clarksdale, and they're imagining what happened here. They're thinking about the music, but they're not thinking about the pain that created that music. And they're looking out and they're seeing maybe an old shotgun shack out on the horizon. They're thinking of something romantic and seeing it as a beautiful ruin. And I just see pain and suffering. So I wanted to deconstruct some of our mythology for people who come here looking to engage with that, but also to deconstruct that mythology for those of us who live here and who sometimes kind of engage in that mythology as well. We are a place that is very much invested in our myths. And one of the things that I think that I try to do in my writing is kind of poke at that. You know, I'm kind of always poking that stick in the cage at that one. So,
I mean, what is the danger of mythology in a place with as much blood in the dirt as Mississippi?
Here's what, this is from, you know, French philosopher Claude Lévi-Strauss. It says that myths are things that make us feel comfortable. They help us confront difficult things. But when they become problematic is when they begin to obscure what's real. And that is the danger of myths, is when they begin to obscure what's real.
And so the title of your book is A Place Like Mississippi. So what's real? Like, what is Mississippi to you?
I'd say there are many Mississippis. And that's what I was really trying to get at. There's so many Mississippis. Being here on the Gulf Coast, that's one of them. Going through my native Piney Woods, and you're talking about, you know, Mississippi being the most documented state. The Piney Woods is the least documented part of Mississippi. Outside of logging, I think the Piney Woods has a beautiful landscape, but no one has really photographed it. And I work with David Wharton at the Center for the Study of Southern Culture. No photographs of the Piney Woods. Tom Rankin, no photographs of the Piney Woods. I go to the WPA guide, there's basically a paragraph on the Piney Woods. So it is this whole part of the state that everybody thinks they can kind of gloss over. It's that this stretch of pine forest between Gulfport and Jackson. And I went around with my camera. A lot of those contemporary photographs of the Piney Woods are photographs that I took. Not that they're stunning photographs or anything, but I had to have something there representing what that landscape looked like right now. So I wanted everyone to see these various parts of Mississippi, not just, you know, the Piney Woods being this place that, as literary critic Noel Polk said, exists outside the Southern myth. I want you to see that part. I want you to see the coast, which is its own Creole-influenced culture. Go to the river towns, which have another influence. I believe that if we had kept our state capital at Natchez, the culture of the state would be very different. We not moved the state capital to Jackson. We would have had much more of a river influenced culture in this state.
Tell people who, you know, because who haven't spent a lot of time either in river towns or in Mississippi, like, well, here's an example. I'll just make it specific. Okay. Greenville, Mississippi is on the river, and Greenwood, Mississippi is sort of the, you know, the last city before the Delta gives way to the hills in a way. I mean, you can keep going to, you can call Grenada the Delta, but we wouldn't do anything crazy like that. But like, tell people the difference between Greenwood and Greenville and how you see the river's influence on those two places.
Greenville is a place that created a lot of writers. It seems like it was in the water there. You know, it's, you know, Hodding Carter's Delta Democrat Times is there. You know, Walker Percy came out there living there with his uncle, William Alexander Percy. Gosh, there's just so many, Ellen Douglas, so many writers out of Greenville. So there's something in a river town where people are coming through. There are lots of other cultural influences that can come in to a river town that don't come into a place like Greenwood that's a little more inland, that don't necessarily come into the Piney Woods either, that come into the Gulf Coast because it's nestled between New Orleans and Mobile. There are all of these geographical differences that create the unique culture of the state.
When you were doing your reading, sort of before you went out and, you know, took that knowledge to the land and turned it into a journey and it became this book, was there anybody's body of work that read different to you today when you were, you know, things that you might have read before or familiar with, but that for some reason they just hit you different?
Probably Walker Percy. I think Walker Percy's work has, we think of Walker Percy as being much more influenced by Louisiana. And I see a lot more Mississippi in Walker Percy when, you know, in the moviegoer, when they stop in Jackson, the detail that he pays attention to there. Or that line in The Last Gentleman where he says, in Mississippi, it's always Wednesday afternoon. And I use that line all the time now. So I reread The Last Gentleman and I thought, well, this character is having this epiphany in the American West that it's different here, but in Mississippi, it's always Wednesday afternoon. So I had to go west to experience this piece of Mississippi. And that's when I realized, yes, Walker Percy is a Mississippi writer.
And The Moviegoer might be the perfect novel. I mean, that's the, like, if you could pick one thing, you're like, boy, I wish I'd have written that. That one might be it.
Oh, well, yes. I mean, I really do. You know, The Moviegoer has become my pandemic novel because, you know, it's everydayness is the enemy. And that's kind of the thing. It's like, everyday is the enemy.
You know, one of the things that I think people are often surprised about is how late parts of Mississippi, especially, frankly, now the most sort of mythologized parts of Mississippi were settled. You know, the Delta was abandoned hardwood swamps, you know, after the West was sort of settled and all of that was over. And so, you know, it's interesting that the blues were born out of the end of this clearing and the hardening of this place into cotton plantations. And, you know, one of the things that you talked about, there are many different Mississippis. And I'm curious what you see when you drive through the Delta in, God, September, when it's all white. Like, what, how emotionally does a field of cotton hit you?
I don't think it hits me the way that someone from the Delta does. I had a very dear friend who grew up in Clarksdale, and our fathers were in college together at Tuskegee. We were having dinner together in Natchez several years ago. And he said to me, if you had grown up in the Mississippi, if your parents had stayed in the Delta, in Milestone and Chula, your life would be, the way you look at life and the way you look at Mississippi would be totally different. And I think that I would look at those fields differently. But I, what I do think about when I see those fields is I think of friends of mine who I knew who worked those fields. I think about my college friend, Judy Johnson, who grew up outside of Batesville, the daughter of sharecroppers, who was picking cotton in that field when she looked out and she saw the troops coming to Oxford and her mother telling her, "Will you see what's happening there? That's going to change your life." So I look at those cotton fields and I do see that pain, but I don't have that connection with it that someone who grew up there in that culture did, because my family, in the wake of the Emmett Till murder, chose to leave. It was just too difficult. You know, as David Halberstam says in the 50s, his book, The 50s.
Open season.
And it was open season on Negroes. And that was when my family moved to the Pine Woods.
What year did they move?
1956.
Wow. So yeah, direct, yeah. Wow, that made the hair stand for my own. I want to end here. Mississippi feels, it always feels important to me writing this book that, you know, every American story lives almost in cartoonish metaphor in a Mississippi story. And, yes. And I'm wondering, for people who are trying to understand both the past and the way forward for our country, what do you hope that people who read this book understand, not just about Mississippi, but about America and our own landscape and the ghost in the dirt?
I want people to experience those ghosts that are in the dirt, but realize that those ghosts in the dirt don't just exist in Mississippi. They exist in this entire country. You know, as I think Faulkner says, "Can't you see this whole place is this land is tainted?" And he is talking about Mississippi, but he's not just talking about Mississippi. He's talking about the nation. All of this land is, and we have to come to terms with that. I want people to look at a story that takes place in Mississippi that may have to deal with some of this pain, issues of race, other issues, and see that it actually puts up a mirror to the nation. It's just like I said, the day that Donald Trump was elected, "Good morning, America, welcome to Mississippi."
Was it everything south of Canada is Mississippi?
Malcolm X said everything south of the Canadian border is Mississippi. And I think the sooner we begin to think about things that way, there's a lot that we can learn from Mississippi, and particularly from our writers, that can be applied to understanding not just the sins of Mississippi, but the sins of the nation.
I can't think of a better place to end that wonderful conversation between the two of you on. Thank you for your honesty, for your interest. And it's, as somebody who grew up in Denver, learning more.
I'm married to a Denverite.
I'm sorry?
I'm someone who's married to a Denverite.
See, there you go. And so, but it's very fascinating. And even yesterday we had an author who's from Maine, and just talking about our beautiful country and the regions that shape us. And so this has been very fascinating coming from two Mississippians and learning more about your area. So thank you. I want to turn it over to audience Q&A, which, for those of you who are watching us right now, there's a chat right next to the video that you're watching us on that you can ask questions on. And I think this is a really great one. And please write, feel free to chime in as you are a writer as well. But Ralph, where did you start when it came to research for this book, and how did it develop over time?
Well, with research, I mean, I think when my editor came to me with the idea to write this book, my editor, Will McKay, there was this idea of everything in Mississippi, the literature came out of the Delta. And I just inverted that. And then I started to come up with lists of writers from each part of the state, thinking about, well, who actually is tied in with that landscape, then engaging with reading some of their work, sometimes going into archives. But I would say that the big archive for this book is not, you know, a literary archive, it's place. So when you are working with place as an archive, as I did, you're creating your own archive. So as I was driving around thinking about these places after I'd read a lot of these things, I'm there with my notebook, and sometimes even with a book on the other, the seat beside me. Like I did that when I went down to where Anne Moody is from, where she describes a place where her family got water from in Coming of Age in Mississippi. And it was with that book there. And the shack is gone, the house is gone, but I found the lake near us. Just kind of, there's the Anne Moody Highway, there's the church where she's buried. I just started going down some roads and looking at the descriptions and figured it out. So place became my biggest archive.
Right. Do you find that setting is very similar when you're doing your research, and how important it is for when you write?
It's one of the reasons that I love this Ralph's book is that, and I never really thought about the influence of this and things I write, but almost everything I write is about place. Yes. And I've never really, I know this sounds dumb and like I'm the biggest unself-aware oaf ever, but it never really occurred to me why that might be. And I mean, I think it's because, you know, I grew up in Clarksdale, Mississippi too, the same town as your friend. And I imagine we had very, very different experiences. And so place is vital to me. I mean, I want every single story or book or anything, even if it's about a person, to feel like it's a letter from X. It's a letter from somewhere.
That's how, I think how your book Pappyland works, is that you're in Kentucky, but then you're at home with your family. And then you're making those connections between your family and this family that you are hoping to have with this family and what they have become over time. That book is all wrapped into place.
I love, you know, Ralph and I talk about this all the time, because I mean, place is everything. And, you know, Mississippi to me is place and sound. You know, I want to know, I'm researching a thing now, and I just found out that this house on the Sunflower River had the first record player in Sunflower County. And they used to play it at night in like 1902. And for miles up and down the river, you could hear it. And like, I've been trying to find the ruins of the house. I didn't find that. I did find that out in the woods on like a duck hunting lease, a abandoned foundation of what must have been an enormous mansion on the river that was basically gone, except that the swimming pool was still there out in the woods with unbelievably beautiful blue tile. It's just a swimming pool out in the woods. And that kind of stuff is everywhere in Mississippi.
That's an image. I got goosebumps when you were talking about the record player. I saw that as like a play in my head, or like a musical, or something about the idea of music being first introduced into a rural area.
But let me say real quick, and this is why it's vital that people buy and read this book. What I was just doing accidentally with the abandoned house was trafficking in the mythology that his book is cutting through. Because what I didn't say is, how do you think they bought that house and that swimming pool? And where, why is it abandoned in the woods now? Where did all the people go? And so one of the things that's really vital about this book is that, you know, through literature and place, it is just taking a machete through mythology, and which is the single most important thing for the future of Mississippi. And like, I just did it. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't even mean to, and I just did the thing. So like, it's
all doing.
You slip into it. And so that's why this book is so important.
I mean, I think we all slip into it, right? There are even times when I felt myself slipping into it. But I think it's because I've got this thing in the back of my head that tells me to kind of dig a little bit deeper and think about those things that I start to question. As I said, it's not something that, you know, it automatically happens and that I automatically see it. It's digging, it's going into the silence.
Yes.
You both were mentioning place and sight and sound as a part of your journeys, but what about taste? The South is known for its food. Did that play any part into your research or your writing? Ralph, I'd love it if you could respond to that.
Well, you know, I thought about food a lot. I stopped a lot of places and ate. Thinking about going to the Delta, eating tamales, just kind of little roadside places too, and stopping to talk with people and learning a little bit about places by talking with strangers. I am known to talk with strangers. I'm an embarrassment to my children because I will talk with anyone. And it's like, Dad, you don't know them. No, I don't, but maybe I could get to know them.
You know, in the food thing you talk about, I make a food TV show, and the host of the show is a mutual friend of Ralph and mine named John T. Edge. And we were in Greenville, and we went in this sort of service station that serves good food. And John T. was like, the guy behind the counter, he's like, have you ever seen that really famous photograph of Robert F. Kennedy and the little kid picking up kernels of corn out of the dirt? And I'm like, yeah, I've seen that picture. And he's like, that's the kid. And he was the guy working behind, he was a grown man now who was the cook. And so, yeah, I mean, the past isn't dead. It isn't even past, as one of the writers you wrote about famously said. The most overquoted line, talk about mythology. God, well, that thing.
The very title of the book is from mythology, because Faulkner didn't say those words. Willie put those words into Faulkner's mouth because Willie Morris thought that Faulkner should have said that.
Wait. You mean Willie Morris? All right, look, we're going to have to talk later. Are you serious?
I am serious. That is from when Ted Atkinson reviewed this manuscript, and I attributed that to Faulkner. He said, no, it's never been attributed to Faulkner. So I start digging around. I look at Faulkner's Mississippi, and Willie Morris writes the introduction for the photographs by William Eggleston. And I asked Joanne Pritchard Morris, his widow, who used to be my landlady when I taught at Millsaps College. And I said, so Joanne, so where did this come from? She said, Willie thought he should have said it. And said, he would never tell. And as I told Joanne, I said, it's just Willie Morris prank calling us from the grave.
Dude, I have the number of corrections I'm going to have to run now. I keep Willie's obit, a photocopy of it, under my visor in my car. Just as a sort of, and Willie Morris is a Mississippi writer. When he died, they basically had his body lay in state at the old state capitol.
Which yes, and Pat Conroy famously said, you know, in Mississippi, they sure do know how to treat a writer. And they sure do.
See what you get when you dig deep, apparently? That's awesome.
Wow.
Well, I even hate to end this conversation and with where it's going. But we love to end on this question here at Tattered Cover, and it does apply to both of you. And so you can interpret it however you like. But what did this book teach you? And I'd love it, Wright, if you could start us off and then Ralph could close us out for the evening.
That's a good question. I think I think it taught me to really make sure to never call my Mississippi which is one of many Mississippis, the Mississippi, which I have been very guilty of, frankly, in the past. But no, it was just a reinforcement that it is a kaleidoscope of broken pieces, and that only when looking at all of them and seeing the space between all of them can you even hope to sort of see the faint outline of the thing itself. But no one Mississippian's experience is in any way a window into understanding the place.
Thank you for that. How about you, Ralph?
Well, I'd say that before I wrote this book, I often made the joke that Mississippi is not a state, it's a club. I think probably the most important thing this book taught me is trying to think about those people who may not feel a part of that club, and realizing this is the poorest state in the Union, which is one of the reasons I chose to end the book at Parchment. Those are people who are not in the club, who will never be in this club. And somehow I wanted to include them. I think that's probably the biggest lesson that this book taught me.
Thank you both. This has been a wonderful conversation, honest, sincere, also hilarious and insightful. There were some great funny moments too. And you know, Ralph, your book was so fascinating to me. Again, as a Denverite, it was such an open window, so to speak, into a world that I'm not as familiar with. And so thank you for providing that. And I want to just let everybody know that you can get copies of A Place Like Mississippi at tattercover.com, and you can get copies of Wright's book as well. Pappyland is his most recent, and you can guys get those on tattercover.com. I want to give you both a chance to remind people who you are, where they can find you online, and anything else you want to say before we end tonight. Wright, if you'll start, and then we can end with our author of the hour.
My name is Wright Thompson. I have a book out now called Pappyland, which you should buy for your 100 closest friends. You can find me online, ESPN.com. I work for ESPN. So I do a bunch of different stuff from them, from write stories to offer my half-baked hot takes about sports. I'm the face you see on mute on your television when you're at a bar.
I'm Ralph Eubanks. I'm teach at the University of Mississippi, and I'm the author of A Place Like Mississippi, as well as two other books, Ever's a Long Time and The House at the End of the Road. You can find me at wralpheubanks.com. And also, I would say, read Pappyland, but also read The Cost of These Dreams. I'm not a sports guy, but I've read every single story in there, and I'm totally engrossed by it. And it's made me think about sports and life in a very different way.
That's very kind. Thanks, Ralph. I'll see you in Oxford.
See you in Oxford.
And that's what we get tonight. Thank you so much for everyone tuning in. Once again, you can get copies of A Place Like Mississippi, Pappyland, and all of the rest of these authors' books at tatterdcover.com. If you two will just stick around for a moment while I close this out here, you can check out our events at tatterdcover.com/event. We thank you guys so much. Some of you, maybe dinner time around there. So we ask that maybe you think about getting dinner from a local mom and pop restaurant, shopping local, and keeping your money in your cities. We wouldn't have gotten through this year without it. So thank you all again. Stay safe, everybody. Happy reading. Bye-bye. And we're out.